Hello, this is Lazarus at telecomTech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the configuration of the PE and CE devices to deploy VPNv4 routes on MPLS. Now, this video is actually the second part of a three-part mini-series covering MPLS VPNv4 routes. In the previous video, we prepared the ISP portion of the network to advertise and share VPNv4 routes over MPLS. We haven't actually advertised any yet, but the ISP network is prepped to have the CE devices connected and to start creating those layer 3 VPNs across the infrastructure. If you haven't seen the previous video, take a look now to get a clearer picture about what we're going to be talking about today. In this video, we'll complete the configuration and we'll also verify that the VPNv4 routes are indeed being advertised and that the network is functioning as expected. And in our next video, which is still yet to come, we'll take a look at the completed configuration and see how VPN labels work, how they're pushed, swapped, and popped. So stay tuned for that. And remember to subscribe to enable notifications and to like this video if you like this video. And if you have questions or feedback, please write them in the comments below. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. Let's take a look at what we did in the previous video, just so that we know where we're starting off today. We configured the PE1, P1, P2, and PE2 routers with the IP addresses you see labeled here. We configured OSPF so that both the loopbacks and the physical interface networks are advertised throughout the MPLS core network, excluding, of course, these customer-facing interfaces on the PE routers. Next, we enabled MPLS on all of the physical interfaces on the P routers and the PE routers such that directly connected devices have established LDP adjacencies, exchanging MPLS labels. Next, we created the appropriate VRF called green within PE1 and PE2, along with the route distinguishers and the route targets that are assigned to those VRFs. Remember, VRFs are created only on PE routers. Once created, the customer-facing interfaces are assigned to that VRF, so this interface and this interface are configured to be on VRF green. And finally, we created the iBGP peering between PE1 and PE2 using multi-protocol BGP. And we enabled the VPNv4 address family on those BGP peerings so that VPNv4 routes can be exchanged. So that's where we are at this point. Now let's go on and finish our configuration so that these two customer networks will be able to communicate with each other while being isolated from other customer networks that may be served by this infrastructure. Let's continue. So let's take a look again at the configuration of BGP as it appears within the PE1 and PE2 routers. Now this configuration as it stands allows PE1 and PE2 to exchange VPNv4 address family routes as well as IPv4 address family routes. The IPv4 address family is exchanged by default, so we don't actually have to explicitly enable it. Nor do we have to explicitly configure the address family command for IPv4. But because label switching takes place on our MPLS network, we don't need to exchange IPv4 routes between PE1 and PE2. So the first thing we'll do here is to disable the IPv4 address family exchange. To do that, we issue the following commands. First, we explicitly configure the IPv4 address family by entering the IPv4 address family configuration mode. And then we issue the no neighbor 4.4.4.4 activate command. This command simply deactivates the sharing of IPv4 address family routes between the PE1 and PE2 routers. What result does this have in the configuration of PE1? The result is that we now have the explicit configuration of the IPv4 address family, and we can see the command no neighbor 4.4.4.4 activate. The neighbor relationship is still up because of the neighbor command here, but the IPv4 routes are no longer shared. Only the VPNv4 routes are active on PE1. Now we need to perform a similar configuration on PE2 as well. We do that as shown here, thus deactivating the advertising of IPv4 routes. So now PE1 and PE2 are only sharing VPNv4 routes. Now let's take a look at our BGP table on PE1 using the show IPBGP command. There's nothing there. That's because this command shows the information shared concerning IPv4 routes, but we're not sharing any. To see our shared VPNv4 routes and the related peerings, we must issue this command. Here we see our neighbor of 4.4.4.4, which is PE2. So now we are ready to connect and configure our PECE peerings. Now for our purposes here, we can choose to use any routing protocol we like, such as OSPF or EIGRP, but I'm going to choose to use an eBGP peering. Since our CE1 and PE1 routers are in different ASs, we will create an eBGP peering. We can do this like so, starting with a config on our CE. We configure our loopback 0, which will represent the network on this customer site that we want to advertise using VPNv4 routes. We create our BGP peering using our AS of 1 and the neighbor address of PE1. And using the network command, we advertise our customer network. Now let's see what we configure on the PE side of the link. We go into our AS100 configuration of BGP, and we go into our address family configuration mode. Now remember, we disabled the IPv4 address family between PE1 and PE2, but here we want to enable it only for the neighbor peering with CE1. So we go into our IPv4 address family and establish the neighbor adjacency using the neighbor command like so. But the most important command at this point is this here, where the IPv4 address family is associated with the VRF green. This command allows the PE to translate the network from CE1 to the VPNv4 route and then to export it into its BGP table. Now let's do the same configuration on the CE2 and PE2 routers as well. Here we see the loopback being assigned the address space that represents our customer network behind CE2. We also create the BGP peering using our neighbor command, and we advertise the customer network we created on the loopback using the network command. And on the PE2 router, we enter the IPv4 address family configuration mode and assign the VRF of green to that address family. And we create the neighbor adjacency with CE2. And we're all set. So let's take a look at our VPNv4 BGP table on PE1 to see what routes we have learned. Using this command here, we can see the VPNv4 routes for our VRF of green, and we see two networks. First of all, we see that both networks are in the VRF green, and they are using a route distinguisher of 100:1. Now I remind you, that's the RD we configured on our PE routers when we configured our green VRFs. And the next hop to reach this destination is the IP address of the CE1 router here. So PE1 now knows, using a VPNv4 route, how to get to our customer network on CE1. And it can now advertise this information using multi-protocol BGP. But it also has a second route, also using the RD of 100:1, and that's the route to 192.168.12.0/24, which is our customer destination on CE2. So we can see here that this route has been learned via iBGP, and the next hop IP is 4.4.4.4, which is the PE2 router. So this is a VPNv4 route learned via iBGP from PE2, and we have also learned the next hop IP, which is that of PE2. Now, if you take a look at the same VPNv4 BGP table on PE2, you will see the network learned from CE2 as an eBGP learned VPNv4 route, and the network learned from CE1 as an iBGP learned VPNv4 route, always using the same RD of 100:1 as configured. So now we have seen how the routes advertised by the CE routers to the PE routers have become VPNv4 routes as they are further shared between the PE routers, allowing them to discover the next hop IP, that is the IP of the PE router, to which the data must be sent to get to its intended destination. Now at this point, we have configured VPNv4 for these two customers. But what we haven't yet seen is how VPN labels are used in this data transmission and how the CEs perceive in their routing tables the remote networks that they learn about. All of that will be discussed in detail in the next video as we continue our learning journey about MPLS VPNv4 routes and customer traffic isolation on an ISP network. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment, and please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at telecomTech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.